And welcome back to Eurogina 120. I'm Jeff Cliff, and this is a series of videos of 120 things that I learned at the University of Regina as part of a computer science degree, which I got in about 2010. And today we're going to be learning about another logical fallacy. As you can notice, most of this list is actually just basic logic stuff. And there's a reason for that, in that it's really hard to go into other fields and to learn complicated topics when you make mistakes that are as simple as this. And this is actually a mistake that I have made as a young person, as recent as 2001, or maybe even 2002, one of the two. And we'll get into that in a bit. But, so what this is, ad hominem attack or logical fallacy, otherwise known as character assassination or a personal quote-unquote attack, is when you, instead of attacking the argument or finding something wrong with the content of what someone says or the argument that they're presenting, and you instead just make a statement relating to their character, usually to make them look bad or to basically attack them rather than their argument. So this is going to be something that's used by people who haven't really got anything else going for them, like intelligence or a better argument, or facts, or control of their own emotions, although it's sometimes also used by savvy politicians and salesmen who know that it generally works on large crowds and uninformed people. Apparently we owe this as a logical fallacy to, among other things, to Galileo, although apparently Aristotle and others earlier than him hinted that this is generally not a good idea. Calling it a fallacy, or at least framing it in terms of logic and logical fallacies, took as long as the 15th century to happen. So, if we're picking apart problems with the arguer instead of the argument, we can get into problems. So, for example, the form of the argument, or one of the three forms, is going to be that person A claims some premise X, and then person B attacks person A, therefore X is false. And so the problem here is that this attack, unless the attack explicitly has some evidence in it that relates to X, in which case it's not really an ad hominem, and we can talk about that a bit more, or more in a bit, this is just irrelevant information. It has nothing to do with whether or not X is true or not. And so it's just something that happens that B does, so that it'll, you know, confuse you or make it seem like you shouldn't believe X, even though you should. There's a variant of this where person A can claim X, person B can claim A can claim X, because Y, where Y is some character trait or something that has, or is not necessarily the cause to not believe X. But of course, B will claim that. This can look innocent, because sometimes it seems convincing that just to believe that what you're claiming, is kind of made to look bad because you also have this other property. So, for example, you could say, you know, marketing is a good thing, and A is a marketer. And then person B can say, well, you would believe that because, you know, your whole life is surrounded by marketers, and you have this, you are a marketer, so you would say that marketing is a good thing. Of course, you know, that purely based on the merit of whether or not, or what A is saying, that is not a respectful and responsible argument against it. There may be reasons why being a marketer can blind you towards whether or not marketing is a good thing, but you'd have to explicitly list them, you'd have to actually prove that they're in effect, or at least suggest that they're in effect, and so on, to make a stronger claim. There's a third variant of this. Where, so person A claims X something, person B claims that A claims X because A is some undesirable thing. And so that, again, it's kind of related to that, where you're basically making a claim that the truth of this depends on the person, and depends on the person's nature, depends on kind of who they are. Now, there may be some instances where this is possible, but a lot of the time it's not, and it's worth keeping an eye out for when this happens. So why don't these types of arguments work? Why is it that when you call someone an idiot and then say that you don't believe them because they're an idiot, what is wrong with that? Well, the problem is that it may be true that or at least one of the problems with that is that it may be true that A, person A is an idiot, and B, that we shouldn't believe a person's claims because they're an idiot. But the pointing out, or the act of pointing out that A is an idiot and that we shouldn't believe their claims because they're an idiot, is kind of predisposes us to not necessarily judge the merit of A's claims even in light of their being an idiot, and even in light of their the connection between judging them and judging their claims. It predisposes our kind of prior distribution of what we should believe in a way that is biased in favor of B. Now, I'm not going to get into why that is. We may talk about later when we get into the video on Bayes and Bayes' rule. But it's just worth keeping in mind that there may even be cases where it's true that A is an idiot, and that may predispose you to not believing him. But if that is the case, then there should be other problems with the argument that you can find. If they are truly an idiot, then it should be easy to defeat their argument and easy to disagree with them and prove that they are incorrect. Because, hey, you're not an idiot, right? So, there's that. And so, in general, you most of the time there's this kind of therefore not X, but of course, and depending who you ask, some may not consider it a logical fallacy if you don't include it, but you don't have to include it. You can just have something like A claims X, and then B claims that A is an idiot, and then the assumption is that X is false. So you'll see a lot of this in IT support help desks, where a user will claim something, and then people in the help desk will say, well, yeah, but they're a user, and that means that they're probably an idiot, so we're not going to believe X, and we're probably going to believe the opposite of X, regardless of whether it's stated or not. This is very, very common, unfortunately. And again, there may be reasons for that. A lot of the times, people who call tech support aren't all that smart. Or there's something wrong with them in the head, or whatever. But it doesn't matter. What matters is whether or not X is true. And so if you can't bring yourself to be above petty personal differences when solving technical problems, man, you're going to be in trouble, because you're going to encounter some people who need help, and you're not going to help them because you'll be too kind of wrapped up in your perception of them that you won't be able to be willing to test their beliefs, to test their hypotheses in order to prove them right or wrong. And sometimes you'll be able to get away with that and they'll just be wrong, but sometimes they won't. And sometimes they'll have information that you won't be able to get any other way. So as other logical fallacies, this is related to other videos we've talked about. The tu quoque, if I'm again pronouncing that right, is an instance of this. You know, if A claims something and then you say, yeah, but you are also guilty of that something, that is in fact an attack on their character. And it can be used as this kind of argument. If the insult is so bad that it warrants physical harm by the audience, or that it warrants physical harm by some legal system, or maybe the SWAT team of your local police station, then this is actually an ad baculum as well as an ad hominem. So you could say something like, well, sure, maybe it is, you know, true that you're correct, but you also kidnap children and torture them. So why would we want to risk reward believing you when you do that, or something like that? And you can, people have gone to the extent of getting people to have SWAT teams show up at their house in response to petty personal differences. And this is just something that happens on the internet. And unfortunately, this is something that happens. So please avoid doing that. It's related to the bandwagon argument, because it makes it really difficult to join a bandwagon if it includes someone who's so unpopular that nobody would want to be near them. So for example, the NAMBLA, which is kind of a pedophile rights organization, if they were to join a cause with you, then other people may not join that cause or would be very skeptical about it. It's kind of like an attempt to keep people from grouping around people, and almost an inverse of the bandwagon, to try to make people avoid you on that grounds. It's related to the argument from emotion, because emotions can start flying pretty high when we start talking about insults and people's honor and character and all that stuff. And if you can get people pissed off enough at your opponent, then they'll raise their level of skepticism about them beyond what is even possibly called for, so that they won't believe him even if he is right or she is right. It's related to the red herring fallacy, because you're basically, and in fact the ignorantio lenci fallacy, because the conclusion, if you make a conclusion using this as a premise, then the conclusion is not based on your premises. It's just pulled right from nowhere. And so it's a complete herring. It has nothing to do with the claim X. It's related to the genetic fallacy, because, again, the genetic fallacy will cause you to make these kinds of claims that say you're dumb because you're in a class of dumb people, therefore you're wrong. Something like that. It's also related to moving the goalposts, because suddenly it's not enough for you to be correct. You have to have good character, too. So, for example, if you are a bridge engineer, and you know how to make bridges, and you know that a bridge as made in front of you is going to collapse, and you try to tell the people, hey, you know, don't build a bridge this way, it's going to collapse, here's why it's going to collapse, here's the engineering tables of the materials you're using, and here's the reasons why, based on those tables and based on the materials you're using, the bridge is going to collapse. And then they say to that, well, yeah, but you have sex with goats, so what do you know, right? This is the epitome of the ad hominem fallacy, where you're ignoring good information coming from a bad person or a bad source, or even sometimes someone who is a good source being made to look bad. As kind of alluded to in the bandwagon argument, it's related to, or another way of looking at this is kind of as a guilt by association thing. So, quote from Wikipedia, I think, my opponent for office just received an endorsement from the Puppy Haters Association of America. Is that the sort of person you would want to vote for, unquote? Well, of course, nobody wants to vote for someone who has, you know, is friends with people who hate puppies or kick puppies. You know, that's just, nobody would do that. And so if you can convince the audience, whether it's true or not, that they are, you know, puppy haters, then they won't pay attention to their argument. If this particular fallacy is used on women enough, for being women enough that they have their own term for it, ad feminem, which is unfortunate. And if you remember from the equivocation video where we suggested that you could judge someone on the number of equivocations that they use, it actually risks doing this. So again, be careful if you do that, because if there's any other way to verify the argument or the person, you should do that instead. That's just a last-ditch resort, or last-resort method. Now, it should be pointed out there are some cases where the person's character and attacks on it as a means of proving something is not actually a logical fallacy. Like other logical fallacies mentioned before, there are some cases where this type of argument is actually valid. Social facts and moral issues sometimes make the case that it's dependent on the character of the person involved. So for example, if you are a judge in Canada, you have to have a good character. If you sleep with your babysitter and are a judge in Canada, that is a problem, and people won't respect you as a judge, and they won't respect the rule of law as much if you are allowed to maintain your office, like Vic Towes, if I'm pronouncing that right, recently did. So again, this is just one example where if your activity is dependent on your character, then it is valid to attack that character as long as the attacks on that character have merit. So in the case of Victaus, he was, in fact, sleeping with his babysitter. Horrible, horrible guy. But, so there's that. It may be when motive is relevant. So if you have a pure motive, that may be worth considering in some cases. I'm a firm believer that impact, not intent, is a wrong way to deal with most situations, and there's certain rules in tort law and other areas of law that are based on this that I find are pretty misguided. However, the alternative to that is taking motive and intent into account. And if you do that, then suddenly this stuff matters, and the character of the person and their intent matters. So what are some examples of this? Well, you could say that, you know, I have more or less the same opinion on what the ad hominem fallacy is as John Locke. And John Locke, directly or indirectly, depending who you read, owned slaves. And slavery is such a horrible thing that anyone who would even be associated with slavers is totally wrong, and so therefore my opinion is invalid. Well, again, it doesn't matter how horrible of a person that John Locke was. What matters is whether or not this is how the ad hominem fallacy works. And you know who else believed that the sky is blue? Hitler. You know, so you wouldn't want to be associated with him. Clearly the sky is some other color, right? No, again, it doesn't work that way. Back about a decade or so ago, Saskatchewan elected a premier who was a minister of the United Church of Canada. Which, by the way, the United Church of Canada is implicated in some of the actions of genocide against the First Nations people in Canada. So, is this something that we should elect, and should we take a person seriously who is a member and, hell, a minister of this church? Well, it turns out that we should have, because, by and large, he did a lot of good things. He had some good policy. The province actually did quite well under him, given what it was doing before he was elected. And, you know, yes, there was problems. Saskatchewan was not a perfect place to live during that period of time. But, by and large, if we had just discounted him and everything he said and all his policies because he was a minister, as I did back when he did so, you would have actually been mistaken. And I was, at the time, mistaken. This is another example of where it's important to kind of notice these things beyond just the heated discussions, is in regards to socially contagious things, such as smoking. Smoking is addictive, and not only is it addictive, it's kind of addictive at a higher level, where if groups start to smoke, they will find it hard for the entire group to stop smoking. So it's not just an individual thing that you get dependent on the nicotine from it, but groups themselves actually have a hard time quitting. And so if you say, as a smoker, to your child, you should quit smoking, and then the child says, yeah, but you smoke, besides being the tu quoque or whatever fallacy, it's also an ad hominem, because whether or not you smoke has no has pretty much no impact on whether or not someone else should or should not smoke, or shouldn't at least. Of course it does. Chances are if someone smokes, you'll be more likely to smoke if you're around them. But if anything, it should go, you know, the opposite way, where, you know, if you know the dangers of smoking, you should be able to convince someone that, hey, you know, you're going to die of cancer, or probably more likely die of cancer if you start smoking. Another kind of thing to note is that if you are in a forum or a public space or even a private space where there is a lot of people being paid to say something, so there's a lot of paid shills or a lot of kind of undercover marketers or people who would say something that they wouldn't necessarily believe just to get other people to believe it, again, based on the Ash conformity experiment, the bandwagon argument, and that sort of thing. But if you're in an environment where you know for a fact that some of the people or a significant percentage are basically saying this sort of thing, then, well, first of all, it becomes easy to accuse people that they're doing so. And two, communication kind of breaks down a little bit, because suddenly, on one side, you have a lot of people being accused of being these kind of marketers, and on the other side, you have people who are actually marketers, probably saying the same thing about the original people who are making the accusations, and so on and so forth. So this can get very messy very quickly, and the same effect happens when a substantial portion of the population is involved with the surveillance apparatus of the state. So, for example, how many people are part of the NSA's PR unit, and how many people are actually going out and trying to make claims about the NSA that are not actually true, and then using the NSA's kind of security apparatus to make those claims. Again, it's not clear, and if you accuse someone of doing so, then it becomes, one, difficult to prove otherwise, but communication as a whole kind of breaks down. So this is actually one of the dangers supporting or not supporting both marketing and undercover marketing and surveillance societies, because not only can this fallacy get used a lot, but it can, the accusations as such can get thrown around a lot. We end up not believing things we should believe and believing things we shouldn't, and so on and so forth. Trolls commit this argument a lot, because you can get people's emotions going, and there's a lot of lulls to be had. Someone accused me of being tone deaf in not interpreting how an argument was supposed to go based on the language involved and their particular use of not this fallacy but another logical fallacy. But you could kind of imagine that someone would say, "Well, you know, you're just accusing me of committing this logical fallacy because you're tone deaf and in the context of conversation, and so therefore my use of it is valid." And that's an interesting thing to say. And I would suggest that it may even be true, but chances are if you're saying it, you're just trying to make the person look bad, so that, you know, the argument is not accepted, which is, of course, the ad hominem fallacy. Another example of this is if you are a religious person and you're arguing with secular people, sometimes the secular people will accuse you of being a crazy religious nut, and therefore they won't listen to anything else you say because you're stupid and religious. And this would be committing the ad hominem fallacy, because sometimes religious people do in fact have good ideas. Isaac Newton was a very religious person, and he had some great ideas, which we'll talk about in a later video. And in general, not everything that they say is wrong and stupid, and so that you shouldn't necessarily discount it before you hear it. Listen to the argument, defeat the argument, not the person. And then kind of a last example, while looking up examples for this video, I found a newspaper article that was written by one Pat Michaels, which was then forwarded by Michael Crichton, basically saying that climate scientist James Hansen was wrong once in the 1980s about the magnitude of climate change, although it turned out he wasn't actually wrong. But assume for a moment that, you know, sometime in the 80s, this scientist made a mistake, he published some information that was not correct, and that therefore, in 2006, after he had done much, much, much more research, and had much, much, much more raw data, and had a lot of data confirming his previous and current hypotheses, and narrowing down the ranges of what they say, that therefore we should disbelieve everything that James Hansen says, because he was wrong once in the 80s. Well, let me tell you, as someone who was born in the 80s, I was wrong a lot in the 80s. And that does not mean that I was right or wrong at all in the 2000s. The 2000s were so much, I mean, there's 20 years between the two of the most scientific research being done in history. The most ideas coming out, the most inventions coming out, the most information produced, everything. The 2000s and 90s, a lot happened, and so you should not merely base something as important as our knowledge of climate science on a single act in the 80s, regardless of what it was, and that is their mistake. And one last point. The internet does not forgive, and it does not forget, and Anonymous certainly doesn't forgive and doesn't forget. And if you win an argument by ad hominem, and that argument is recorded by the internet, and the internet remembers that, it's only a matter of time, because before somebody takes and scripts something up to look for that particular argument, and to see your action in that argument, and to basically publicly show that you, at least in that particular argument, should have lost. Of course, it won't inform the perception of you in future arguments, but it could certainly lose you a little bit of status, it could certainly make you look bad, etc. And so, in general, I as an older person, grew up in a time where the internet did not remember everything we said, that there wasn't this Google thing to be able to track down whether or not we made an argument that was incorrect once. We live in a different world today, and so you shouldn't merely insult people and just hope that that's good enough, because it just isn't anymore. The world has changed. Attack the argument, not the person, and go from there. So, as usual, if you would like to insult me and the goat I came in on, feel free to do so in anywhere where this video is posted. As usual, our whiteboard markers are dying. Please send us some Bitcoin so we can get some more. Hopefully you enjoy. I will see you next video.